Here at Christie's, we expect this to be our strongest auction of contemporary art. We have the Rothko, the Pollock, the Jeff Koons, but the highlight of the night will be Kion Wolf's Red Cat Looking at a Purple Dog. The market is very interested in this painting, and we have no way to predict how it will go.
I'm here for the wolf. I would not wipe my bottom with the other ones.
I have a bid of 33 million. Do I have 34? Yes, 34.
The chances to buy a wolf of this magnitude does not come along very often.
We are now at 57 million. Do I have 60?
60?
Yes, that is 60 million.
Excuse me, it's me, Kion Wolf. Can someone stop the music? All right, this is madness, and I refuse to be a part of it. I make art for social and aesthetic purposes, not to see how much it can sell for. It has become arbitrary and fetishistic, frankly. To you guys, it's like the work itself doesn't matter as much as the name and the price tag, and that's wrong. By the way, where was the bidding on Red Cat Looking at Purple Dog?
It is now at 60 million and continuing.
Really? Well, what I was going to say is, starting tomorrow, we really have to seriously start looking at this, right? Because something is way out of whack. But for now, I'm just going to go out in the snack bar, as you were.
Do I have 65 million? How about 70?
70!
Yes, 70 million.
Today on the show, we're asking, where do these prices come from? How does the market decide what a painting is worth? And now, the man who bought Aristotle contemplating a bust of Dolly Parton, Colin McEnroe.
Yeah, welcome. This show started, I think, as a sort of a result of three things, or at least three things kind of cemented our determination to do this show. It all really began when one of our interns, Greg Dyson, came to us with this very fundamental idea. He was wondering, where do these prices do come from? Why certain pieces of art go for astronomical amounts of money? And by astronomical amounts of money, I probably don't have to tell you. You read the news. You know that a triptych portrait by the British modernist painter Francis Bacon recently sold for $142.4 million, a record for a work of art at auction, and that a silver car crash, a silkscreen print by Andy Warhol, brought in $105.4 million. You know these kinds of prices. So Greg was sort of saying, well, where do these prices come from, and how does the whole market regulate itself? I mean, you can kind of understand how the bourse works to moderate the price of oil, regulate the price of oil, kind of. You can sort of understand that. You can even sort of maybe understand why one piece of real estate might be worth more than another piece of real estate. But really, in the world of art, it didn't seem – I mean, Greg sort of wondered anyway. Was there some comparable law of logic, something that was more – discernible by the human mind than it appeared to be. So that was step one. Step two, I think, was a one-hour conversation we had with Deborah Solomon, or that I had with Deborah Solomon on the air about her biography of Norman Rockwell. It was just sort of, it was the day before Thanksgiving. We had a great conversation. I noted on the air that there was a major Rockwell auction coming up, and lo and behold, about 7 to 10 days later, a Rockwell went for, let's see, $46.1 million. That was Saying Grace by Rockwell. So, I mean, these prices are huge, and yet not all of the prices are huge. This may sort of be kind of a leading edge phenomenon, and one of the things we want to look at a more granular level today is this sort of about almost kind of a mirror of what's happening in the rest of society, which is that increasingly money and power is concentrated in the hands of a few, and everybody else is kind of left to fend for their own devices. So Greg started looking into this. One of the people he talked to was Alex Rosenberg, a New York-based appraiser and the head of Alex Rosenberg Fine Arts. Just to get the conversation started, let's hear a first clip. This is from an earlier interview of Alex Rosenberg by Greg.
Art in general is not become so expensive. It is only at the top rung where the super billionaires are bidding against each other for art. It's a very limited market, and even though it's highly publicized, it represents a small percentage of the sales. I think the reason for these high prices that we have now is merely that these people have so much money and that there is the use of the money to show power. I mean, whereas years ago we used to brag if we bought something below a certain price, what others paid, let's say, today they brag that they paid more. And as I say, it's a display of power more than an investment or even a love for art. They surely have no affinity for the art.
That's one count you heard from. Nick Palmgarten, writing about this in The New Yorker, a profile of one of the real mega dealers of the world of art, wrote, "Once you have hundreds of millions of dollars, it's hard to know where to put it all. Art is transportable, unregulated, glamorous, arcane, beautiful, difficult. It is easier to store than oil, more esoteric than diamonds, more durable than political influence. Its elusive valuation makes it conducive to extremely creative tax accounting." They're in a similar way kind of explaining what's going on here. But that only really opens up the question. I mean, it only begins the conversation. So, yeah, maybe we understand there are some people with a lot of money and they're looking for a place to put it. There's still a question about why certain things get chosen over other things. And that's one of the places we want to dwell a bit today. With us is Elaine Stainton. She is an art appraiser and executive director of paintings and drawings at Doyle, New York. That's an auction house. Also with us, Patrick McCacky, art historian, critic, former director of the Yale Center of British Art. We'll bring him in just a second. A little bit later on the show, your mind, being the lurid thing that it is, probably also wonders, well, you know, in that whole environment, what happens to works that are stolen? I mean, who buys those? So Bob Whitman, former head of the FBI art crimes team, will join us to tell you a little bit about that. But let's stay on the legitimate side of the street to begin with. And Elaine Stainton, listening to everything that's been said so far, including my babbling, maybe you can begin to sort of educate us a bit on you know, is there a way to sort of look at this whole world of art and understand why a Francis Bacon would go for so much money? I mean, it seems to be the kind of thing that at least the auction houses have some kind of sense of before the auction starts. How do you know what it is that you do know?
Well, you watch what sales are doing. One of the things that advantages we have as an auction house is to see who's bidding on things and what lots attract a lot of bidders. I noticed before nearly every sale, and this is modest sales as well as important sales, I noticed before nearly every sale there are several lots, perhaps five, in an entire sale of, say, 150 lots. Or I'm talking about the painting section of a sale because mm-hmm. that's what I do. There will be maybe a handful where there will be 25 bidders lined up on the telephone already. Mm-hmm. Now, normally you may have maybe have one or two phone bidders, one or two left bids. People show up and bid from the room. Some people bid on the internet. What we find is that invariably there are a few lots that there will be 10 times the number of bidders lined up to bid than will be on other things. And what invariably you see is that it's a name artist, that someone whose name is recognizable, and that it's a particularly nice example. Now, what does nice mean? Nice means a classic statement. Let's say, all right, Jackson Pollock. People have a sense of what a Jackson Pollock looks like, what that painting. It's dripping, paintings of Jackson Pollock, gestural paintings, action painting. We know in his youth he did other kinds of things. Those things are less valuable because they aren't what people expect to see of Jackson Pollock. So first of all, what makes the special charisma of a work of art that attracts a lot of bidding is a classic statement by that artist.
You go ahead. Finish your thought.
I was thinking contrary-wise. Let's say you have a painting by Boucher, the French 18th century artist who's known for his lovely ladies and beautiful voluptuous goddesses and beautiful pastels. If you have a picture of a couple wrinkled old people, you know, in a bar, getting drunk together, that's so antithetical to what we expect from Boucher. It's the opposite of the classic statement. A painting like that could sell for actually very little.
Particularly if it had that title, a couple of wrinkled old people getting drunk in a bar. That would be a poor choice of title. You heard one of the other people who was interviewed by Greg say that a lot of this stuff is happening at the top of the market. This is also reflected in the piece that ran in the New York Times maybe about a week and a half ago, that, you know, there are all these headline sales, but they don't necessarily represent what the market is doing or even how art works these days as an investment compared to putting your money in an indexed stock fund. Can you comment on that a little bit?
Sure. It's certainly true that the staggering price, $142 million, $80 million, $60 million, prices like that, of course, are happening at the very top. But I see the same dynamic even on the less valuable things. the artist who usually sells for, let's say, in the range of $50,000 to $80,000, and if you get a particularly wonderful example, a classic statement, as I like to say, a classic example of the artist's work in good condition, add a few other things. One of the things, by the way, that made that Francis Bacon so valuable was that it was of the artist Lucian Freud. Lucian Freud is an equally glamorous figure. So you have the glamour of Francis Bacon combined with the glamour of Lucian Freud, and it was a triptych, so you got three for one. There was a lot of value packed into that. But I find the same dynamic happening, as I said, at artists of a much lower level, even artists who sell for less than $10,000. Let's say an artist's normal range is in the range of $3,000 to $5,000. A really nice one might sell for, say, $15,000. That's because that's the one everybody wants. You want that look? Here's a particularly expressive, high-keyed, beautiful example of what this artist does. So the same dynamic actually happens on the lower levels, too. But Alex Rosenberg was absolutely right to say these staggering prices that you see, $142 million, $80 million, whatnot, that's the very top tier, and the people who buy at that level actually think about art quite differently than the people who are paying $10,000 for a work.
Let's hear a little bit more, Alex Rosenberg. This is clip two, Wilfie, Galleries Today. This is Alex Rosenberg, kind of following up on what you just said, sort of what the reality is for galleries these days.
Considered to be a hot artist, one that the wealthy people are acquiring. It's very difficult to sustain a gallery today. In fact, whereas when I had a gallery in the 70s, we employed 8 to 11 people. Today, there's usually the owner and one person, and they go to lunch. The gallery's closed. The entire operation has changed enormously because the sales to the middle class are not dependable. In fact, the middle class is selling art in order to sustain itself. It is not a buying public. It is more a selling public. So that if you look at the sales at Sotheby's and Christie's, Christie's had 6 pieces in this recent sale that were priced at $20 million or more and referred to as masterpieces. Now, they're not all masterpieces. They're merely expensive pieces. But we've reached a point where quality and money are synonymous.
Okay, there's a lot of material in that one little clip, and so we'll come back to some of it. I want to bring Patrick McCackie into this conversation, art historian, critic, former director of the Yale Center for British Art. We had hoped to have Patrick in studio with us today, but the weather, the uncharitable weather, intervened and kept him in the south of the state. So, Patrick, you know, just to sort of come back to this whole idea of the megastar artist, you know, at the beginning of that Alex Rosenberg clip, I don't know how audible it was, he said, unless you have what is considered to be a hot artist, one that wealthy people are acquiring. And, you know, by now, we know the names of some of these artists. And in fact, Elaine just mentioned a few of them. And so, yes, you have a Francis Bacon portrait of Lucian Freud, which is, I guess, the modern equivalent of Aristotle contemplating a bust of Homer. So how do they become megastar artists? How does that happen? Why that one artist as opposed to another? And good afternoon, by the way.
Good afternoon, Colin. Well, if we take the case of Francis Bacon, he's been a significant artist ever since the years immediately following World War II. He's been a well-known figure, a figure of great fame, repute, notoriety, if you like. And so he's a well-established figure with retrospectives at the Metropolitan Museum, at the Tate, in Paris, at the Grand Palais, and so on. So there's an accumulated history to him and an accumulated consensus of judgment that he is one of the most important artists to work in Europe post-1945, and that contributes heavily to it. And the other thing is that he has a very, very distinctive style, a style which, frankly, is only very poorly imitated when people try it. So there's this extraordinary thing about the exceptional nature of his work, and in this case, of the Lucian Freud triptych, there is none other like it. He's quite a large oeuvre, Bacon, but there is no other triptych portrait on the scale of Lucian Freud. So the rarity of the object plays a very important part in the high price.
But Patrick, are we discussing a rule or an exception here? In other words, you make a very eloquent case for the esteem that Francis Bacon enjoys, and for kind of for his accumulated history. But some of these other megastars who kind of jump out, do they jump out because of that kind of pedigree, or do they jump out because some group of people, some Illuminati somewhere, decide, you know, of a moment that this artist is going to become important and expensive?
Well, that's a slightly paranoid view of contemporary art sales, that is a conspiracy theory. Well, I mean, if you take an artist at the other end of the thing, Jeff Koons, who's also kind of a megastar both in reputation and price, there's no question that he is the darling and the plaything of private collectors. And what's very interesting is that nearly always it's private collectors who make the reputation of an artist, not museums. And in the case of Koons, he's the great prankster. I mean, the art is easy to like. It's amusing. It's fun. And it's quite spectacular, too. So it has all the kind of things that would appeal to somebody who's looking for something which is flashy, easily read, amusing. Everybody knows it costs a great deal of money. It is the kind of the plaything of the rich. Now, do I think that Jeff Koons is as good an investment as Francis Bacon? I most certainly don't. But he's there at the moment. He's a plaything. And again and again, in the history of art, there have been wildly popular artists in their time who descend and enter the shadows as time goes by.
I mean, let me just flip this back over to Elaine Staton for a second. As you're listening to Patrick speak, is this something that makes some kind of sense? I mean, I think he makes a very articulate case for it making some kind of sense. Does it make sense to you when you see the money that coagulates around certain very hot artists? Do you understand why that is? And does it feel intellectually defensible to you?
Well, I do understand in most cases. Sometimes I don't. To tell the truth, I don't exactly understand why Jeff Koons's orange balloon dog should be the highest priced piece ever sold by a living artist. That to me feels like it's one of many, and I don't quite get it. Except what Mr. McCackie said about the sort of the glamour, the stir up, everybody interested in this very. I gather he's a very charming man, for example, makes a point of making friends with his collectors and so on. So yeah, this is a man who's cultivated a reputation. But I don't quite get it in that case so much as in the case of Francis Bacon, who, Mr. McCackie quite rightly says, was well-established art historically as an important artist decades before his prices got stupendously high. So many of these judgments of the market are in fact based on judgments of art historians, judgments of critics, judgments of serious collectors who make serious choices about the art, even as it's coming into view. So even an emerging artist, people become interested in them for serious reasons. So in general, I think the market actually speaks with a voice very close to that of art historians and critics.
Right. When it comes to Francis Bacon, Mr. McCackie, you know, will always stick up for someone with Dublin roots. Not that he needs sticking up for. You know, Patrick, I want to just ask you also about sort of the social side of this. Obviously, there are artistic discernments you can make, and they are discernments based on both aesthetics and history. But my sense, and reading Nick Palmgarten's profile of David Zwirner kind of accentuated this, is that there's this other incredibly complicated thing. It's like this vast international bazaar that's floating around to all these exotic locations. These works go on sale. There are huge players in the form of dealers and speculators. My own crude, untutored sense of it, Patrick, is it's not a pure aesthetic judgment, right? There's a huge amount of a social factor and perhaps even a little bit of a faddishness about it.
Yes. I mean, it is surely the evidence of a sort of new Gilded Age, kind of conspicuous consumption. But in the past, when the great robber barons were paying what appeared to be absolutely mega prices for old master paintings, for Rembrandt, for Gainsborough, Velasquez, and so on, They did it in a highly competitive spirit that, you know, Frick had the better Titian than somebody else had. Henry Huntington had the greatest of all Gainsborough and the Blue Boy. There was this highly competitive world between collectors then. I think it's always been part of art collecting at the high, high end. You want to have the best thing. I mean, always my heart always sinks when I run to a New York collector and says, oh, you must come up and see my Stellas. Well, they're Frank Stellas. They're not my Stellas. And there's a sort of the sheer pride or a flatus of ownership, I think, is unquestionably part of art buying at its very top end.
And Elaine Stanton, I'd like both of you to talk about this a little bit. But, I mean, I would assume that with each passing decade, this market becomes more intensely globalized. You know, you were talking earlier, Elaine, about just the number of calls that might already be waiting, 25 phone calls waiting on a piece at auction. And I'm assuming that with each passing decade, those 25 calls are more disparately spread across the globe.
Yeah, I mean, we've never had a period in which there are now so many billionaires so widely distributed throughout the world. I mean, for years and years, it was a European and American thing. Then the first, as it were, non-European American buyers into the field were the Japanese in the 1980s. Don't you remember the great scare? The Japanese were going to buy up all of Western art, and they paid the first record sums for Van Gogh, Sunflowers, and so on. But now it's not just the Japanese, it's the Chinese, it's the Russians, it's in Latin America. It's a huge distribution of super capital throughout the world. And they all want to compete for the same kinds of works of art. So that the market and the money that's available for the market has expanded exponentially in the last 20 years.
So I want to, Patrick, I want to ask Elaine then, you know, given that, given the kind of globalization of the art market, do you have a sense of whether that changes taste? And I'm using taste as a placeholder for whatever word it really is that describes the avidity with which people would approach any given work of art. Does the globalization, the spreading out of the buyers, do they still sort of basically chase the same butterflies that they would chase if they were only Western Europeans, or has it changed things at all?
Well, certainly in the modern field, they're chasing the same things. Many of the same artists are when we have a major modern artist for sale, we get bids from Tashkent. We get them from Melbourne, Australia. We get them from cities in China. We get, when you have one of these well-known, internationally known artists, you certainly do have bids from all over the globe. Now, that's not true of every market, though. The Russian market, for example, when we have a nice Russian painting, our bids are from Russians. Now, they may live in London, they may live in somewhere in the U.S., they may live elsewhere in Europe, or even in Russia, we get bids from Russia, you know, from the Russian Federation. But it's still Russians all bidding on these Russian paintings. The Japanese aren't interested in them. The Danes aren't buying them. It's the Russians. Likewise, we had a Brazilian painting a couple of years ago. We put it in at a modest value because we didn't realize how very appealing it would be to Brazilians, and it went sky high, and all the bids were from either Brazil or from Brazilians living in Paris or London or whatever. So there are many niche markets that are quite nationalistic in flavor, but there's a lot of money in those too.
Let me grab a call from Christina in Hartford. Hi, Christina. You're on the air.
Hey, Colin. So this is a really interesting conversation because Banksy, who's a pretty famous British graffiti artist who is in New York in October for a month-long residency, essentially did a one-day pop-up in Central Park where he sold his work for $60 a piece, but he just put an elderly man there with a sign that said spray art for $60. Now, Banksy sells up in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. So it was very interesting. It took 4 hours before his first painting sold, and people are negotiating 50% deals. At the end of the day, I think he made $400 and some for 8 of his paintings. So, you know, this is a guy who isn't allowing, to some extent, the market to dictate, you know, his prices. So I found that to be really interesting. I have since purchased a Banksy from his shop on fab.com for $35, but it's one of these canvas pieces.
Well, Christina, you actually opened up several different cans of worms here, all of which I'm interested in rooting around in. I think maybe the thing to do, we'll take a quick break. We'll come back with more of Elaine Stanton and Patrick McCackie after this.
Not give all your privacy away. A little bit of hype can be effective, long as you can keep it in perspective. After all, without some recognition, no one's going to give you a commission. Art isn't easy. Overnight, you're a trend. You're the right combination, and the trend's at an end. You're suddenly last year's sensation. If you feel a sense of coalition, then you never really stand alone. If you want to work to reach fruition, what you need's a link with your tradition, and of course a prominent commission. Plus a little formal recognition so that you can go on exhibit, so that your work can go on exhibition.
All right, we're back. We're talking about the value of art and who decides about the value of art. And we are lucky to have with us Elaine Stanton, art appraiser and executive director of paintings and drawings at Doyle New York Auction House. Patrick McCackie, art historian, critic, and former director of the Yale Center for British Art, also with us. And Christina, I believe I can say that was Christina Newman Hartford Scott. I recognized her voice. Opened up a couple of really interesting cans of worms. So one of them, I think, is sort of the Philistinish question that often comes up, which is if you offered a bunch of Kandinskys for sale in the park and didn't say whether they were Kandinskys, would anybody know and would anybody want to pay a lot of money for them? And the other one is, and maybe we can start with this one, and I'll start with you, Patrick, on this. You know, there seems to be a certain class of artist who's experimenting at different ends of the economic spectrum with thumbing his or her nose at everything we just spent the last half hour talking about. On the one end, you have Banksy engineering situations in which his work goes for very little money. And then on the other hand, and maybe you'll say that I misspeak, but on the other hand, you have somebody like Damien Hirst, who at times seems to be playing kind of a conceptual game of look how much money I can get for something, you know, that's a shark in formaldehyde or a golden calf or something. You know, look at how much money that the market itself has become to a certain degree part of his overall artistic concept. Can you say something about that, including possibly you're wrong, McEnroe?
You're probably right about Damien Hirst. I mean, he is somebody who has seen that the art market is a kind of conceptual game where he can play. But that doesn't mean that he's not a very good artist. I mean, when he did this fantastic thing of getting his dealer, Larry Gagosian, in every one of Gagosian's 11 galleries spread throughout the world, would for 1 month hang nothing but his dot paintings, and they were all over. Mm-hmm. And I went around just Gagosian's 3 galleries in New York, and it was incredibly amusing. I mean, the variation that he was able to get out of his dot paintings was extraordinary. And you came away thinking what a very good and serious artist he is. But he definitely likes money, and he likes gaming the system. At one stage, as you know, he completely bypassed the dealers and went directly had a special auction at Sotheby's, in which he did very, very, very well. And in a way, you know, there's nothing kind of sinful or wrong about it. It's his way. Nobody else seems to be able to do it. And I'm rather amused by him. And by the way, the shark in formaldehyde is a great work of art, very sinister. It's dead, but it doesn't look that dead. Now, as for would people know a bunch of Kandinskys if they were offered to you in Central Park? Of course you know when they buy Kandinsky and not by somebody else. And one of the most obvious and crazy things is that people are always trying to fake Pollock. They think it's very easy to just strip the paint this way and that way. And almost every single Pollock fake I've seen looks awful, looks like a fake. Because it just simply doesn't have the kind of inspiration that Jackson Pollock brought to his work. And that it's, remember, it's always, you know, you can only fake something if you've seen the original first, and you're always, therefore, in some ways, making a copy, and a copy is always going to have telltale signs of being weaker than the original work.
You know, Elaine Stanton, one of your jobs as an art appraiser is to look at all this work and bring to bear all of your skills, your understanding of the history of art, your aesthetic skills, your connoisseurship, and a bunch of other things that I'm too ignorant even to think of the names of, and figure out what a piece of art is potentially worth. Although it seems to me as we get into some of these people like Damien Hirst, or Koons for that matter, they're sort of challenging you a little bit. I mean, what skills can you have other than just looking back at what other things have sold for? How can you make make an appraisal of some of this stuff.
Well, that's exactly, that is the problem of doing an appraisal. First of all, if something is common, you can find other examples of similar works that have sold, and you can say, well, this made X and that made Y, and so this is perhaps a little better than X or a little less good than X or a little better than Y. And you can kind of triangulate and say, well, if that's, then this ought to be about this figure in the middle here. But let's say you have an artist that is really quite rare, and you don't see works of his very often, or the work that you're looking at is highly unusual, atypical in some way, and or let's get back to my classic statement, Frey. If we say it's a classic statement of the artist, it's one of the best things I've ever seen by this person, in his own terms, that is his very distinctive style, then you're guessing. It's an educated guess. You're trying hard. You try to step into the mind of the buyer and think, if I, as a lover of this artist, if I had endless money to buy, what would I be willing to pay for this? And often I approach it that way. This is the best painting by this artist I've ever seen. If I were megabucks, didn't have to think about value or cost, what would I pay? And that's sometimes how you have to approach it. But usually I have to say most appraising is less challenging than that, because most things you appraise are more commonly seen and do appear, similar works do appear at auction.
All right.
You're right.
Yeah, go ahead. Finish your thought. Go ahead.
No, you're right. Let's say in the case of we often find in the case of works that made stupendous prices at auction, because they were unusually fine in the sense, and that's true of this Francis Bacon of Lucian Freud, by the way. It's a great painting by him. And it's, again, it was three of them. It's unusually large. The subject was important. All of these things, nothing like that actually had ever appeared. And I've forgotten what the estimate was, but it was considerably less than the price.
Of course, the next night, a silk screen print, Silver Car Crash, Double Disaster, mm-hmm. by Warhol, brought in $105.4 million. And I wonder if it's possible to see the same things about something like that you just said about the Francis Bacon. Like, can it really be considered so exemplary so far? I mean, isn't sort of there's something inherent about Warhol that defeats that statement?
Well, yes, you're right, because the whole cult of multiple imagery, which was so fostered by Warhol and everything he did, but that is part of the Warhol price structure. I'm often completely baffled by Warhol, because you will get several examples that appear to be very similar, and one will have made an enormously larger price when sold. So it does make it difficult. Warhol is an interesting case because, rather like Jeff Koons, and like Damien Hirst, part of his approach to art has to do with playing the market and gaming the system and actually playing collectors and critics and various other interested people almost against each other and kind of leading them on a chase. So with artists like that, where there's a component of publicity and glamour and hype, then it's a much trickier business.
Okay, well, we had a similar but darker and far more jaundiced quote about this, Greg Dyson did, from Alex Rosenberg, whose jaundiced and dark and paranoid outlook I'm beginning to enjoy. So let's play clip four on pretty much the same topic.
It's almost a conspiracy, but I hate to use that word because I don't mean it that way. But if the auction houses and the very powerful dealers, like Gagosian as an example, and the purchasers and sellers of this expensive art get together, then you have this tremendous price comes up. It's a cooperation. I mean, the auction houses want to sell that which sells for the most because they make a commission. The dealer is representing the artist. He wants to. So when you have a combination of the three, the buyer, the auction house, and the gallery, all on the same wavelength, you have a promotion that drives the prices up. I mean, look at the hype that this Bacon thing got.
All right, we're talking about the price of art. By the way, our number, 860-275-7266. 860-275-7266. So, Patrick McCackie, you're listening to all this. I'd love your reaction to almost anything that just got said, but But he does describe that chase, you know, it is, and the chase that Elaine described, and then that's almost an art in itself, manufacturing that level of avid interest in a certain artist. And is that a game that is being played at a higher level and for bigger stakes than in years past? I guess everything we've said so far would suggest that that's true.
Yes, I think one of the things that has already been kind of tacitly acknowledged in this discussion is that one of the things that makes works of art a great rarity and a great beauty and a great interest and therefore huge prices is that they always contain a narrative of some kind. Not necessarily inside the painting, you know, as a sort of story being told, but they accrue a narrative around them. I mean, I always think a very interesting example of that is the wonderful Duccio, Madonna and Child, that Philippe de Montebello bought for the Metropolitan at the stupendous price of $40 million. And the painting is the size of a sheet of typing paper. And yet, Duccio is the very beginnings of a high Western, serious Western painting at the turn of the 13th into the 14th century. And there is no other painting but Duccio in private hands. And the painting itself is a marvel. I mean, this Madonna and Child is a small kind of earthly parapet at the bottom of the painting, and suddenly this huge Madonna looms up over the parapet, the real kind of Queen of Heaven. Now, it's such a tremendous story that the painting takes some of its quality and interest from that. Sometimes it's who's owned the painting beforehand. I mean, J.P. Morgan always liked to buy pictures if they've been owned by fading Italian princes before him. And that's part of the narrative of the work. And that plays a very big part indeed. And I think in the case of the wall, more and more I think it's being acknowledged that Warhol's greatest works are pictures of dead, of disasters, of death, of tragedy, and so on. The electric chair paintings, the car crashes, the race riots, and so on. And these are being seen as a new, more serious level to Warhol's art than we've generally treated him before.
Do you think all of this, Patrick, for a living artist, does it begin to affect the living artist and his attitude towards his own work? In other words, do artists whose work goes for a lot of money start thinking more and more in terms of that and less in terms of the aesthetic forces that drove them to art in the first place?
Yeah, I think there is an element in that. I mean, one of the things that I think every contemporary artist has to watch is that they simply don't go into producing the work that sells, going into production rather than continuing to work out of conviction and trying to push their art forward. That certainly is there. And you must remember that New York is always in love with a really bad artist at any given moment, and sometimes in love with more than one bad artist. And these are often very ephemeral figures. And one of the most curious things about the contemporary art scene at present is that Warhol's prediction that everyone will be famous for 15 minutes has come true. Everyone can be famous for one or two seasons in New York and then suddenly just fade out. And you hardly ever hear their name again.
Elaine Stainton, obviously you love art. That's why you're in the job that you're in. You love art and you're smart about art. On the other hand, when you see this money, I'm going to just quote to you from the New York Times article that seems to be one of our Rosetta Stones here today. Michael Findley, author of The Value of Art and a director at the Aquavilla Galleries in New York, said, "What I believe in is the social and aesthetic value of art. We live in a society where everything is so monetized. The only way people can talk about art is in terms of money." Does that strike a chord with you? I mean, does it sometimes, even though it's sort of the business you're in, obviously, does all of this fixation on the price tag bother you at times?
I don't think about it very much. I have to say I disagree with what Mr. Findley said, and I have every great respect for him. But I don't find that's true. I find people come to us and they look at works of art and they... I've had clients stand in front of a painting. They'll come in early before the exhibition even to see a work. I've seen some of these people have tears in their eyes at what they're looking at. It's not – my experience of my clients is that they are art lovers. Now, maybe that's because I'm not really selling very much to hedge fund billionaires. And Alex Rosenberg may be absolutely right about that these are competitive people who are trying to outbid each other. And maybe Michael Findley has more experience of those people, too. I find that my clients, even clients who can write big checks, great collectors, actually, who have wonderful collections, are greatly moved by the art that they buy. So I actually disagree with that.
All right. Well, that's kind of heartening to hear, actually. We're going to take a quick break right now. We'll come back with more of what we've been doing, plus the world of stolen art after this.
Sometimes rain that's needed falls. We float like two lovers in a painting by Chagall. All around the sky and blue town.
Only $15 million for my dogs playing poker with Elvis? The black velvet alone is worth half that. Today's show was produced by Betsy Kaplan and me, and the concept and execution came from our excellent intern, Greg Dyson. Greg Hill tweets for us and appeared in the intro with Tucker Ives and Betsy Kaplan. The part of Bill Curry was played by Stevie Wonder and the Beatles, because it's Bill Curry's birthday. For links, stories, photos, and gifts of the staff of the Faith Middleton Show completing their conceptual artwork, Great White Shark in a clear plastic case, and then realizing that the shark is still alive. No! Visit our website, WNPR.org. On tomorrow's show, a conversation with author Daniel Menaker about books, magazines, cancer, mistakes, and the literary life. And now, back to Colin.
And for those of you who want to see the Kion Wolf painting, is it Purple Cat looking at a red dog? Red Cat looking at a purple dog, which I believe was going for $70 million in the intro. You can go to WNPR.org, go to the Colin McEnroe Show site, and I think we have that up there now. She has actually rendered that for us. All right, so we continue to have with us Elaine Stanton and Patrick McCackey. We're going to add to this conversation also Robert Whitman. Now, Robert Whitman is the guy who goes and finds these things when they get stolen. He's the former head of the FBI Art Crimes Team and the author of Priceless, How I Went Undercover to Save the World's Stolen Treasures. And we should say that not only does he recover paintings by Rockwell, Rembrandt, Pissarro, Monet, and Picasso, but also various kinds of antiquities. Those of you who heard the show that we did with David Howard about the theft of the original copy of the Bill of Rights, the North Carolina copy of the Bill of Rights, may or may not remember that Bob Whitman was a big part of that story as well. So he's with us now. And so, you know, Bob Whitman, we've just had this fascinating conversation, at least I hope it was a fascinating conversation, about how art is valued and when art is sold, when it's auctioned, how prices are arrived at. But now we have this whole other world of people who steal these things. And I think a lot of people wonder when they read about the theft of some fabulous, famous, iconic work of art, or a work of art at least that's by an iconic artist, who in the world are they going to sell such a thing to? Who can manage to own a Rembrandt or a Monet or a Picasso? What's the answer to that question?
Well, Colin, it's great to be here, number one. And it is a very interesting conversation you've been having. It's a little different, though. That conversation is a little bit different from this one. You know, the thing that makes an artwork valuable is it's the history, it's the authenticity, but it's also good title, which is the piece that we're missing whenever you're talking about stolen art. So ultimately, when we're talking about someone who goes out and steals a Rembrandt and tries to sell it, you know, on the black market, well, usually, from my experience from 25 years of doing these investigations where we recovered more than $300 million worth of this material, you know, the people I've worked with undercover, usually I'm usually an undercover person doing, you know, buying or something of that nature. These are thieves who are good criminals, but they're terrible businessmen. So what they do is they go out and they steal the painting and they think they can sell it. And ultimately, they end up selling it back to people like me that were the police.
Well, that seemed like an unproductive activity. You know, how much more? I have a sense. Actually, I'd love to hear Patrick on this too, but I'm going to ask you first, Bob Whitman. Is there more art theft going on than the average person realizes. I always feel like whether it's a museum or a gallery or a private collector, the number of art thefts that actually turn up in the newspaper represent a small percentage or at least a lesser percentage of a larger whole. How right am I about that?
Well, as I say in my book, Priceless, what it is this. It's about a $6 billion industry. That's the estimates from different countries around the world, including Interpol. It's about $6 billion a year is moving in the illicit cultural trade market. Now, the vast majority of that, Colin, is not art theft. It's the other. It's fakes, frauds, and forgeries, which are the three Fs. I call it the three Fs of art crime. And that's a much larger part of the market than theft. What happens is when there's a theft in the Paris Museum of Modern Art or the Swedish National Museum in Stockholm or something of that nature, it makes the front page stories. Everyone's reading about it and talking about the theft itself. But the truth is, that's small compared to the amount of forgeries and fakes and frauds that are going on.
So the people who are doing that kind of work, the forgeries and fakes, they are probably more. And we did do a whole show about forgeries and fakes, they are sort of a more analogous to what we've been talking about here so far. In other words, they see a market. They see a market for work that is deemed legitimate, and they're just trying to create more of that work that will strike people incorrectly as legitimate work, right?
Right. It depends on what it is. I mean, if it's an outright fake, then it's going to be a painting or an artwork that's done in the style of an artist. If it's a forgery, okay, it's a copy. And, it's being sold as the work of the artist. So it depends on the situation. But, yeah, you're right. Those people who are doing those types of things, number one, they have a little bit more of the ability to sell. They have to have some type of market they can get into. And number two, they have the ability to create the object. But the thieves, the other group, they're just common criminals who are out there doing it for, wherever they can get. And they're likening a Rembrandt, or let's say they're likening a Monet to a Chevrolet. Okay, to them, it's both the same property.
We're fast running out of time, but Patrick, since I have you here and since you've run two museums during the time that I've known about you, to what degree is any of this on the mind of people who run museums? I mean, theft happens and it happens to museums. Is it such an esoteric and odd thing that people in the museum or gallery business don't think about it until it happens? Or is it somewhere near uppermost in your mind at times?
No, I think people think about it a great deal. I mean, it's like, the theft is going to be unlikely that they're going to steal your Titian, your Caravaggio, your Cezanne, and so on. What you have to watch is that it's the smaller object which is so easily pocketed by simply walking around a museum. And once you're in the museum and you've got it in your bag or over an overcoat, it's easy to pass in and out of the museum without being detected. And you can't wire up every single object in your museum for sound. It is a great and constant fear is the securing of the collection for any museum director. And, one can see, we have still the most terrible example of all. The theft from Isabella Stewart Garden, which are now 20 years old, in which a major museum had inadequate security services, inadequate security protocols, and just laid itself open and had four or five of its finest works removed. So that haunts. I remember that the day after the Isabella Stewart Gardner theft happened, I said to my head of security, could that have happened here? But somebody walked in at 2 o'clock in the morning, say they were from the FBI, and walked away with our best things. And I was very comforted to hear that it was an impossible scenario, that the guards knew about certain security protocols which had to be carried out, and that not even the Lord's anointed could walk in without a proper system into the watch that knew at 2 o'clock in the morning.
That is comforting to hear. We're going to have to sort of wrap things up there. Although, Elaine Stanton, I want to give you the last word. I've only got 20 or 30 seconds for you to have that last word. But since we've been talking a lot about theft, let's talk about something nice, happier. What's a good investment these days if you're an art collector? What should you be buying in like 20 seconds?
Really good representational paintings, 19th century American or European paintings of things that look like things.
Fabulous answer. All right, head off to the Doyle in New York and buy some of those paintings. Elaine Stanton, it was such an honor to have you. Patrick McCacky, always great to talk to you. Thanks to Bob Whitman, too.
Meet James and Sorn. Belgium's famous painter.
I'm Kyon Wolf, just hanging my latest piece of art, the C-section of Kirsten, Venus's ignored half-sister. Well, at least the tear is in the right place.